this next review is our review of the Privelege 5.0, now rebranded the Privelege 510. Privelege are a French company that have a reputation for building top-of-the-range luxury catamarans. Let's go and see what this one looks like. So let's start this review, as we always do, with a good look at safety and design. The boat shown here is the Privelege 5.0. This has just been replaced by the 510.
So this is the homing position, and it feels a little bit like you're in a spaceship. It's just
you actually like, look like a dwarf.
I know, I feel
you are miniature. Dwarfed by that helm position.
I feel tiny. It is huge.
I would say that's the most beautiful helm suit I've ever seen. Wow.
So from the helm, the visibility is fantastic. The helm station is well laid out. The solid windscreen is a real boon, and there are clever and sensible little touches like switch guards to stop you accidentally engaging your winches. One thing that became apparent on the very windy day that we were filming is that solid dodger and bimini above really does provide a good level of protection from the elements. I was also impressed with clever little touches like dedicated storage bins for the lines, fold down footrests. It's a really comfortable helm. Another thing to note is the number of handrails. These are everywhere. They cover the entire length of the coach roof and will allow very safe and stable passage across deck. Something to note as we move forward is that the guardrails are solid stainless steel. They are not wire. That is a fantastic safety addition to any boat. I was going to say that I would like to have seen flush mounted hatches, but apparently the 510 has them as standard. Access to the coach roof is easy via steps. This would be a very easy and safe deck to work. I'm super happy with this boat. My only niggle is that I couldn't see a dedicated life raft cradle, and so have no idea how easy that would be to deploy. As such, we're going to award this a 9 out of 10. Fantastic boat. We were unfortunately unable to access the engine bay on this Privelege, so we're going to move straight on to looking at other areas for build quality.
Look at this. The quality of this joinery.
That's leather.
And that, beautiful. It's oak, I think. It looks like oak.
The quality of the finish on this boat was absolutely astounding. Everything had such a high level of craftsmanship that it is almost impossible to fault. From routed work surfaces to fantastic woodwork, custom built appliances integrated into galleys, saloons and the bedrooms. The joinery and finish are top notch, and there are clever little features. For instance, here we've got telescopic table legs to turn this into a coffee table. There were two Privelege 5.0s at the boat show, and they are bespoke, so you can make as many changes as you could possibly want to the interior of these boats, from wood finish to materials, and everything is absolutely superbly finished. Interesting to see the two different 5.0s at the boat show. This one was a completely electric boat, and from the looks of it, the owner wants to do some serious passage making. The fittings and equipment were all absolutely top-notch, the best that money could buy, from integrated fridge freezers, dishwashers, cookers, fantastic. The exterior showed the same level of workmanship, fantastic overbuilt shrouds, that's what I like to see. Look at those stainless steel rails, the standing rigging and mast, again, all super sturdy. Very, very happy with this boat, there is absolutely nothing I can fault with it. From the quality of the teak deck to the rigidity of the davit system with integrated solar panels, this boat is absolutely fantastic. We therefore are going to happily give the Privelege 5.0, 5.1 a 10 out of 10.
Let's now take a look at the interior design of the Privelege 5.0. This takes into account everything that makes Privelege a comfortable and easy catamaran to live on. Let's start with the cockpit. The cockpit is a great space, really hard to fault. There's plenty of seating options as well as a folding dining table. I'm not sure how customizable the cockpit area is, but nonetheless, there's everything that you need here. There's a really great hardtop bimini with two opening hatches, great for ventilation. And the helm also communicates well with the cockpit, which we really like. The Privileges do offer a lot of customization options, so much of what we're about to see is owner's choice, but it will give us an idea of what options you get when you're buying a Privilege. One of the first things that I noticed was that there was no forward-facing nav station. The nav station is facing aft. The saloon, just like the cockpit, is really hard to fault. This particular owner has gone for the black leather look, which I'm not necessarily a fan of, but it's obviously his choice. And there's plenty of room for your mod cons as well. Speakers, flat screen TVs, and even a wine fridge.
It's got nice big opening hatches. 1, 2, 3.
Dishwasher. Double fridge, ice machine, manager.
I know, but this is what you get when you spend this much money on
luggage. Look at that, wok burner.
Yeah. Okay, let's move on to the actual...
Well, let's look at some other things, like the chart table.
Yeah. This is a backward facing chart table. Yeah. This seems a little bit nonsensical. So my thoughts here are that like you would struggle with, there's not very good visibility on the inside from a watchkeeping point of view. You really would need to be at the helm position in order to do your watch.
So let's go down and have a look at one of the hulls now. The woodwork, as you can see, is absolutely phenomenal. Nick is clearly very happy about all this. Going forward, there is some guest accommodation on this particular model. Again, this is an option. We'll see the other option in just a moment. This owner has chosen to go for the forward guest cabin as well as a small shower room.
And then there's a separate toilet, which is nice. Okay, so this is another cabin. Presumably this is an option to have two single berths rather than queen. Again, ventilation, got one opening hatch there and one more here, so not the best as far as ventilation is concerned. And then your guests will have a shower. Okay, I don't want to break anything. There's a shower room in there and a separate toilet in there, and you can close off this entire room. And the same with the forward cabin as well, you can close that off. Okay. So again, same as on port side. Got the two single beds, the opening hatch above, and the nice big window there with the smaller opening hatch. Let's have a look in here. Prepare to be amazed, I think. So you've got your workspace, that's nice. And you've got loads of storage with another big mirror. And then you've got your bathroom. Nick, why don't you, as much as you're adding to the general look of the place, why don't you let our viewers... Come on, I know what you're staring at. Why don't you go that way?
This is depressingly beautiful.
Okay, so loads of storage. Nice big bathroom area, or shower room area with a shower. Nice. A rain shower situation with a hatch. Now this is what Nick is having a gentleman's moment over.
Don't tell me that you're standing it out here.
Well, I've been on one of these before, so.
I've actually forgotten it. I had this cabin.
Yeah, I hadn't. This is the stuff that dreams are made of.
Shit.
I mean, all I would say is that obviously there's no head height, so you're still crouching to get into your bed. Like, even I can't stand upright. But you've got a lovely, obviously, big, I don't know what that is, maybe queen size bed. It's huge. Why don't you get your tape measure on it?
I'm not even gonna bother.
Big opening hatch there. And then two smaller opening hatches here.
Wow.
But once again, let's just have a moment, Nick.
I've been having a moment since I got on this boat.
Just think about this, right?
Yes.
You're in an anchorage in the Caribbean. It's tropical. Mm-hmm. You don't leave your hatches open all night because you'll get rained on. So you're closing your big hatch here and your two smaller ones here. Where's your ventilation coming from?
Below the massive air conditioning unit that we're pumping everything out at 22 degrees while it's like Lassie's bringing me chilled bloody water.
It's true.
That's where it comes from. Gen set on this is going to be.
Yeah, and this is the thing with these kind of boats, like you have to rely on your gen set and your AC. There's another opening hatch here. So when the weather's nice, you'll get loads of ventilation, but if you're in the tropics, it definitely won't always be clear skies.
So as you may recall, that model had a forward guest cabin, which affected the size of the master cabin. Now let's take a look at the other option, which is a master cabin spanning the full forward section of the boat.
I mean, it's incredible that they can fit a cabin this size into a 50-foot boat.
You can get to this main cabin through both holes.
You know what that means? We can just run round like cats. Yeah, they're kind of, it's very apparent how when they say that you can customize this, how this is totally different to the other one.
Yeah, it's an interesting comparison. I mean, in style, it's very, very different.
Yeah, and this is obviously set up far more for kind of like some hardcore passage making.
Why? Tell me why.
Well, there's look behind you. There's another chart plotter there.
Oh yeah.
Someone obviously wants to be able to get out of bed and look at stuff. You can tell from the way the like the chart table and all the electronics are laid out. These people want to sail. They're sailors.
Let's take a look at the guest accommodation on this catamaran. As you can see on this particular model, they had opted for a queen size bed, which was positioned athwart ships.
So you've got loads of underfloor storage. God knows what's under here. Not about to start lifting it up. And then you've got a guest cabin, which is nice. The bed is sideways.
As we've said, it was really good to have the two models there. That way we could see exactly what the options were. And as you can see, this owner has gone for a somewhat different aesthetic and a few changes to the layout as well. It was hard to know what to score this. I'll be interested to see what everyone else thinks. It was obviously a beautiful floating home, but I have some concerns over the practicalities of this being a sailing boat and living on it while underway or at anchor. For example, that master cabin, while incredibly impressive, has very little headroom. The ventilation is good, although I question whether it would be very good when it's raining and you have to close your hatches. There's no forward-facing nav station, and I question how comfortable that master cabin would be while underway. I'm not sure that's the most comfortable part of the boat to be sleeping in. For now, I'm giving it 8 out of 10.
So let's look at some statistics and performance figures for the Privelege Series 5. The boat is a long boat. The LOA of this boat is 56 foot, so she is large. The beam, we are looking at 8 meters or 26 foot. So again, getting that into a double berth in a marina is going to be difficult. The draft is 1.6 meters, and this boat does not have dagger boards. It just has mini keels. Displacement 16 tons, so she is a heavy boat. She is not going to perform overly well either to windward or downwind. If we look at the polar diagrams that Privilege kindly provided us, you can see that while performance isn't absolutely sluggish, it is neither scintillating. She is going to plod along, but you're going to plod along in a lot of comfort. So based on these performance figures, we are going to award the Privilege Series 5 a 5 out of 10. Now for the part I can imagine you've all been waiting for, value for money of this amazing craft. The base price is over €1 million. That is almost $1.2 million. That's 921,000 British pounds. Fully spec'd, the boat on show here was €1.6 million. That's $1.8 million and £1.4 million British pounds. And none of these figures add the tax locally. So add 20% if you are in Europe onto this. So when we are looking at value for money, we are going to award the Privilege Series 5 and 510 a 3 out of 10. The reason for this is, although it is a fiercely expensive boat, and if you've got the money, you're going to spend the money, you are paying for French labor rates. The labor rates in France are far, far higher than you will find outside of Europe. And so you pay a premium for this.
So that was the hugely impressive Privelege 5.0, now rebranded the Privelege 510. A very, very impressive boat. What are your thoughts?
It was great, actually, because the Grand Mott had two models there.
Yep.
So both of them were quite different from each other. So we were able to see two kind of variations of the same boat. It is quite customizable, obviously, as you've seen. And the highlights for me, I mean, the build quality was exceptional.
Yep.
It was just... it was so impressive. It was so beautifully done. Everything was just so beautifully done. And that is important to us, not yes. just from a safety point of view, but also aesthetically. It was just gorgeous. There's really no two ways about it. It was beautiful. The helm position was the best helm position, I think, that we saw that day. I can't think of a better one.
I tend to agree with you, yeah.
It was just so well protected.
Yep.
In the perfect place. I really like those helm positions that are up a little bit higher, but still connected to the cockpit. And I mean, it's almost completely enclosed and you've got that hard, I would call it, I guess,
It's a screen.
Screen, yeah. Everything was there that you needed and it just seemed like the perfect place to position yourself when on passage.
Yep. I agree with you. It is very difficult to pick holes in this boat.
I mean, that master cabin is something else, especially on the one that had access from both sides.
Yep.
The ensuite, the open ensuite.
Look, I gushed enough about this boat while we were reviewing it.
Yeah.
It is only fair that we go through the positives and then go through the negatives, as we always do.
Mm.
The build quality is this boat's kind of like... forte, the fact that it is so well built, it is beautiful. And as you said, there were two 5.0s there, both very, very different boats, and both very, it was a good example of how this boat is semi-customizable, it is all bespoke, almost down to, you know, the hulls. I mean, obviously the bulkheads are in, well, actually the bulkheads are not all in place because there was a complete walkthrough in one place.
Yeah.
But, you know, the boat with the orange interior, the kind of orange leather, was really, you could see it had been set up to work as a good standard workhorse, liveaboard, circumnavigator, a real navigator's boat. And the other boat was just set up, you know, gym palace is the wrong word, but it was set up as an uber luxurious, you know, floating catamaran. It's fantastic.
Floating home.
Floating home, yeah, absolutely. And that is something that we do talk about a lot, how we're looking for our new home. And we had a lovely home, and we have a lovely boat. And it is nice to take that level of luxury to another boat, albeit at a price. One thing I do want to mention is that the boat that was made in orange leather was a completely electric boat.
Yeah.
And that is something, as we move into the 21st century, it is nice to see, and I hope that more manufacturers follow suit with this. I have previously expressed my reservations about fully electric boats. However, as the technology improves, I think they become more and more viable, reliable, and more of an option.
Yeah.
So that boat, induction hobs, completely electric, huge lithium battery bank, electric engines, completely green, and that's a fantastic thing. So so build quality, fantastic. The electric options, fantastic. The customizability of that boat, fantastic. The living space, literally just wow. And little things, it's not just the overall things. Things like the thickness of the teak. You know, I was on another production catamaran last week in La Rochelle. The teak that they were putting down in the workshop was 1 to 2 millimeters thick. It was literally, it was almost see-through. Just the
like a veneer.
Yeah, it was almost like a veneer, but this is what they were walking on. But this, literally, it's good, good quality. And so it speaks for itself. So the positives, it is very, very easy to run on about a huge series of positives about this boat. Let us try and pick some holes in it negatively. Let's put some negatives to everybody. Negatives.
Well, I don't think that you can pick any holes in the build quality, not from what we could see. I think that there are a few, what I would consider to be relatively minor drawbacks. The homing position, while absolutely fantastic, was the only helming position. There was no inside nav station.
Yep.
There was, but it wasn't for sitting at and navigating from, really. You
yep.
couldn't do, there was no forward-facing station that you could do your watches on overnight, for example. And even if there was, the visibility from inside is not as good as other
yep.
boats that we see. Although perfectly fine, it didn't offer that same like amount of visibility from inside the boat. I don't think that's a major issue because the helm position that they have is so very fantastic.
Yep.
You can, there aren't many conditions where you would need to be inside.
No.
You could be out there, you know, in anything really, and you'll be well protected. So that isn't a major issue for me. The ventilation
yep.
was a little bit disappointing. In the aft cabins, there was only two opening hatches, and I do bang on about ventilation, and I don't know, maybe some of you are sick of hearing about it. I think Nick probably is. But I think that it is important. You have to be comfortable while at anchor, and most of these boats are going to the tropics, and so having good natural ventilation is something that I think about. However, all I would say again on that topic is that I think if you're spending the type of money that you're spending on these boats,
mm-hmm.
then you aren't worrying about spending money on a generator and AC. So these boats would all have
yeah.
air conditioning, and you are probably going to be a little bit more okay with running the genset and the AC.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, when you're kind of sailing on a budget, you're trying to keep costs down, and, you know, running the AC all night is not particularly cost effective,
yep.
but it might not be an issue for these owners. But yeah, the only other issue that I have that I am is a little bit more of a red line, although I'd be interested to hear any privileged owners who might have experience, actually, including Sailing Zatara, who many of you may watch. They have a YouTube channel. The master cabin is in a very unique position. And I wonder how comfortable it would be sleeping in there while underway,
yep.
as opposed to being in the
hold. It's right under the bridge deck.
It's right under the bridge deck, so you get a lot of slack, and also presumably, well, it's in the middle of the boat. I don't know.
We need to find out.
This is the unknown.
Yep. And that brings me neatly onto something that we obviously, this is video review number 7. And we seem to get the same comments from people, you know, why aren't you dealing with bridge deck clearance? Why aren't you dealing with hull slap? Why aren't you dealing with all these things?
Mm-hmm.
And the reason is that bridge deck clearance and hull slap, bridge deck clearance is not the only factor that contributes to hull slap
mm-hmm.
at all. It's, you know, how the boat's being sailed. It's the shape of the nacelle underneath.
It's laden down.
Yeah, absolutely. And this is not a light boat. It's quite a heavy boat.
Yeah, it's not a performance boat.
It's not a performance catamaran.
No.
And while the performance is, you know, it's not sluggish. It's not fast. It's a heavy boat.
Mm.
It draws 1.6 meters, which is kind of like what our old boat used to draw. You know, with our old keel monohull.
Mm.
It doesn't have, it doesn't point very high.
Mm.
So it's not a fast boat. But, you know, when it's that beautiful, just go slow. So it's performance is never going to be this boat's strong point.
Mm.
I am, as I've already said, picking holes. You know, this is a beautiful, beautiful boat.
Yeah.
And really, it's only for the sake of review that I'm kind of nitpicking a little bit. So the performance is not sparkling.
Mm.
Second thing is, and let's just deal with the bleeding obvious here, it is fiercely expensive. You know, it is expensive, and really, you know, 1.5 million euros plus tax. That when you take that into the UK, you're looking at 2 million euros. That's 1.8 million euros for that boat, which, you know, is beyond most of us.
Yeah.
You know, short of selling kidneys, winning the lottery, that is beyond most of us.
Mm.
And this, you know, if you've got that sort of money, you want to buy a catamaran, fair enough.
Mm.
The reason that I marked it down for value for money is not simply because it costs that much money.
Mm.
It is that the boat is built in France,
mm.
and French labour rates are quite high,
mm.
compared to the premium manufacturers that build outside of Europe or outside of France.
Mm.
So when you are buying a boat, you know, that is of that standard, you are paying even more percentage of the cost of the boat for manufacturing and
mm.
for labour, and if you're having it built in France, you just pay so much more. There are boats that we have yet to review. Nisner built in South Africa, Antares built in Argentina, and also the Seawind we've already reviewed built in Vietnam. The quality of those finishes is superb, but they pay a lower rate, labor rate. And as such, and it's all overseen by the manufacturer, it's not like it's just shipped out to some factory and they're like, make us a boat. As such, you get better value for money because you are not paying inflated labor rates. So the cost of it has marked it down. So, but you know, if you've got that money, much money to spend, spend it. But you're not going to get the value of money for money because you are spending it on French labor rates.
Yeah.
And just to be aware here, everyone, you know, for those that may say, yeah, but French labor is better than Vietnamese labor, or better than South African labor, have a look at the other reviews of French boats that have been built in France. It's not guaranteed. You're not guaranteed to get the fantastic labor. So that's the first thing. The second thing is about this boat is that because they are so customizable, you pay heavily for that premium. And we have said quite openly, we're not just looking for new boats, we're looking for used boats as well, because they're out of our price range. And where you have such a crazy variation in the ability to customize the boat, you also may be open to the kind of whims of the owners who want kind of like purple leather or kind of
green carpets
or green carpets. So you do have to be aware. And so where you've got boats that aren't so customizable, you tend to get a more standard finish. And that, but again, these are very, very small points. But as I said, overall, just picking holes in this boat. Beautiful boat. The lack of forward-facing nav station is almost a deal-breaker for us because we want to do such long passages.
Oh, I think the cost is a deal-breaker.
Oh, yeah, and the cost, Oh, for sure. No, it's an amazing boat.
Yeah.
If I had the money, would I buy one? I'm not sure. I still think...
Yeah.
I still think for me, it is beautiful. Maybe in 10, 15 years' time when we've won the lottery and our YouTube channel has 25 million viewers and we're getting... But it's a little ostentatious for me. And I think that comes out, it is beautiful, but maybe it's not quite for us.
Not for us.
No, we're not posh enough. I think that's what it comes down to. We're just not posh enough.
Even if we had the money, we definitely don't.
So, beautiful. A few minor issues, but nothing crazy. And that's I think that's a fair summary, don't you?
Yeah.
Anyway, thank you for watching this one. Now listen, for all of those who of you have been following this series, the app is going great guns. There's a link down below. Please leave your own reviews and your own scores for this boat. It's super important because as the scores come in, it removes our potential bias of the view of the boat. I mean, obviously we filmed it, but if you are an owner, if you have seen one of these boats yourself at a show, or if you've just watched our review and you think, actually, I want to score that slightly differently, please score it, because the more reviews that people leave, and it's really simple, you just click and then there's a slider to leave your own scores, the more valid the review is.
Yeah.
So thank you for watching that one. The next video in the series, I think we've definitely got the Utrecht to do, and we are now heading to the Annapolis Boat Show, so we have quite a few reviews of those catamarans that we haven't yet viewed. So we'll be back soon with a new one, so goodbye.